Croeso nôl pawb. Welcome back, everyone, to Fearless in Devotion, sponsored by the Fat Boar Bar and Restaurant, as you all know by now. I'm joined this week by Tim and Andy. No Liam. How are you both, gents?
Well, where's this pawb come from? You throw me here.
Pawb means everyone. I'm welcoming everyone back.
All right. Can we discuss this in a meeting before you just throw something new in?
I'm afraid not. How are
I'm
you?
I'm on the back foot here.
How are you?
I'm all right. I'm okay.
How are you, Tim?
Dog shit, mate. Dog shit.
Well, there we go. A rare stinker of a weekend for Wrexham fans. Obviously, the men lost 1-0 away at Gillingham. The women lost 5-1 to Stourbridge, although that was only a friendly, though, and it was good to see Rosie Hughes back on the score sheet. Next up for them, Welsh Cup semi-final on March 3rd, so big good luck for that. Let's turn our attention back to the men for now, though, because it was pretty poor, Andy.
Yeah, I went. I quite like the whole day. Again, you know, I keep saying there's nothing like a good away day with good pals. Got off at Rochester, had a few beers. I was really lucky. It's the sort of thing that you really get into the stand and you think, right, we're going to do something here. We're absolutely going to do something. You've got that feeling in your bones and the players. Yeah, okay. I thought the first half was fine. I didn't really think we would really score, but we held them at bay. And I thought, well, you know, a 0-0 is not too bad. And then one dubious free kick, we're 1-0 down. And we don't really look like we're going to score. I'm going to be absolutely honest. I've got no problem with us losing. We're going to lose games, all right? But I want to know that we've actually given it to them and we've actually laid a glove on them and they know they've been in a game. And I'm not really sure we did in the second half. I think it was quite a limp affair, if I'm being absolutely honest. Tim, you watched it on TV. What did you think?
Frustrating again, you know. I was looking at this before. I was like, I was trying to put a bit of gloss to things today. When was the last time we played really well away from home? We said the other week, probably Notts County. That was October, you know, and the rest have been like, that was a 2-0. We've won at Crawley 1-0. Won at Swindon 1-0. We're just edging these little few and far between wins that we've had on the road. But it's just annoying. It was an annoying performance because the ability is there in abundance. We can all see it. We played really well in the first half. A lot of sweeping passages of play. But what annoyed me is that there was just lacked conviction in terms of finishing. It's like the amount of space that they're creating, but when using it wisely. Like, there's a couple of occasions where you just thought, go on, Barney, cut inside and have a go. You know, he
didn't do that.
Defense, and you just wanted him to... I mean, he lashed at one, I know. I think there was a couple of better occasions that presented themselves to him that he could have done better with. It was just frustrating because you just knew that it was one of those classic cases, similar to Bradford. The longer it went on, they were just going to nick something. And so it proved again, and such a crappy goal to give. But let's be honest, the second half was, we offered nothing. We offered nothing. And you know, he chucked all the subs on a bit late, but you know, it didn't really happen, did it? I think it'll be, there's always a mini head loss after a defeat. But I tell you what, there's a lot riding on Tuesday against Forest Green, because if we don't
get
anything from that, yeah, then people will start quite rightly asking some questions with justification, because I know we sneaked it as certain, we made it probably harder work from it a bit than we should have done, but Forest Green have just come off a good win against Tranmere, an informed Tranmere team. So they're no mugs. They're fighting for their lives, but we have to. Parky keeps saying, oh, we'll put things right starting on Tuesday. It's got to start at some point because we're less than 2 months away from the end of the season. So we're now running out.
Games, 13 games left, mate. 13 games. Six of them away. A lot of them left against lower teams.
Doesn't seem like many, does it? Parky?
No.
Getting serious.
Yeah, no, I know. I was just a little bit disappointed we didn't play Luke Young. And
yeah, what do you think that was about? Because he played really well, didn't he?
He covered everything. We were actually a front foot team on Tuesday night because Luke Young was actually getting it and actually turning over and making us sort of break the lines a little bit, and it was very, very frustrating that we weren't able to do that. I think McLean and Lee were just occupying each other's space. They're very left-sided. They drift to the same sort of place because that's where they're comfortable. And you just wanted Luke Young to really put the foot on the ball and maybe go long if you have to, but certainly turn their defence around because they weren't great going forward. Gills just aren't a very good attacking team. But what they will do is stay in there because they're quite well balanced defensively. And all of a sudden you give them a set play and they did go ahead. And after they went ahead, I'll be honest, I didn't think we were going to get back into it.
We haven't really seen the best of our signings yet, have we? I think it's fair to say. No. I mean, Bolton and Marriott, for example. I mean, Tim, what have you made of what we've seen so far? And, you know, do you get the sense that, you know, for Marriott in particular, you know, once that sort of first goal, once he gets a couple of goals, then we're going to see sort of him right at his best?
No. whatever you do, don't put a tweet out saying, have we kept the receipts for Marriott and Bolton? Because you get pelters for it.
Oh, did you? I didn't see that.
It was more tongue-in-cheek because I was a bit of context. Like, you know, when we had Palmer, he came in, hit the ground running, scored in his debut, impact. The point I was trying to make was, obviously, you know, we're not going to send them back. They're good players, but I'm surprised.
Can't send them back, mate. Fleetwood aren't going to take them.
Yeah, I'm just thinking a month in with Saturday, Tuesday games, and I'm just trying to figure out what really they've added to what we've got rid of and what's come in. There's no doubt in their pedigree. Bolton was perhaps a little bit fortunate that he didn't get sent off the other day. You know, took his booking, which is reckless, and then he could have got carded not long after that. I think, and I said this to somebody else the other day, I think the reason that the spotlight is on them, particularly Marriott, is because of the drop-off in form of the other strikers. So we're almost expecting him to come in and pick up where the others have fallen, dropped off a bit. And that's maybe a little bit unfair, I don't know.
I get the sense that when Marriott scores, he's going to really hit the ground running. But anyway, I think it's time for us to introduce our guest for this week, who is a friend of the podcast, as long-suffering listeners will know. He's been on many times before, always good value. Humphrey, executive director of the club, how are you?
I'm very well, how are you? I'm just making my earphones go through, or making my sound go through my earphones.
Okay.
Where are you, Humphrey?
Can you hear us?
Oh yeah, now I hear you. I've got you.
Good. Andy was asking, where are you?
I've jacked into the Matrix via my headphones. I'm in Los Angeles.
Lovely. Any Wrexham artwork?
Afternoon?
Any Wrexham artwork on the wall behind you?
If I move my head, you might be able to see just here. They've got a little miniature National League trophy replica. Lovely. Got various signed shirts and things hanging in different rooms around the place here. But no, this is the sitting room. So
yeah,
I'm not allowed to completely Wrexham bomb the walls here.
No, that's fair enough. Listen, Humphrey, let's get straight into it. You know, we've won 2 games in 8 in all competitions, fallen out of the automatic promotion spots. We sit at the lowly fourth place in the table. When are you sacking the manager and the board, and when are you resigning? That's what I want to know.
Well, I mean, I've tried to resign on many occasions in the last week or so, and have been turned down. I don't know how the first part of your conversation was. I mean, I obviously, it's hard to avoid the sort of. I mean, I'm one someone who does look on the Twitter and the you know, sometimes people very helpfully will come on my Instagram to tell me to you know, pictures of my dog, appropriate forum to tell people to fire other people from their jobs and things like that. I as you say, a lowly fourth place. I mean, it's devastating. It's devastating stuff.
Is it one of those ones where, you know, we've had such a good start? This is where I say, you know, perspective is so important, because if any of us here had been shown that table in August and say, would you take it? There's absolutely none of us that would have turned that down, right? It's just obviously there's a little bit of a slump going on, and those are always really frustrating, aren't they?
Yeah, I mean, you know, ultimately our results since Christmas have been, you know, not what any of us want, really, whether you're fans or whether you're management or whether you're players or anything like that. So, you know, there's no escaping from that. I think ultimately, as you say, perspective is important, and it's a difficult thing to gain. I mean, I think really the events of the last couple of years have possibly, you know, put people into a position where it's like, you've got to win every single game. You know, they used to watching the Premier League in the last 5 years, which, you know, whether we like it or not, is sort of the wellspring for a lot of our general conception of football, has become this situation where it's like, Man City drew a game, well, that's their season over. You know, I mean, you last week it was sort of, you know, Liverpool lost against Arsenal, and suddenly it was like, well, Man City have won the league, and then Man City drew at West Ham, and suddenly Liverpool have won the league. And
yeah,
you know, a thing that I saw was, there was sort of a little snippet from Sky Sports that's made its way across my internet desk of you know, various people talking about, well, March is the key month in the Premier League, and March is, if Liverpool win out in March, they'll win the whole thing. If Manchester City win, they'll win the whole thing. And I think it's really skewed our perspective on football. You know, I think going into February, we all knew we had lots of away games, we had tough away games, we were expecting, you know, I listen to your podcast from time to time. I don't want you to get too big-headed. And, you know, I think the general consensus amongst you and us was, well, look, we've got a difficult run of games here. We've got to go, you know, away to Milton Keynes, got to go away to Gillingham. And I think, you know, lots of the kind of general conception was like, those are two games that, you know, we can't be expecting to get much out of those games. We've got to do well elsewhere. I think from my perspective, the thing that I said yesterday in our kind of group chat was like, look, the game against Milton Keynes Dons and Gillingham away, both represented kind of quite a big shift from some of the away performances we've seen previously. We had much more control of the game. We you know, created a lot of good chances. Yes, we probably should have taken them. We didn't. That's disappointing. But the trend, you know, I texted Phil after Milton Keynes and said, like, look, I'm sure you're really disappointed that we didn't win that game. But if we play like that in all our remaining away games, we're going to win more games than we're going to lose. And, you know, the reality remains that in this division, with the way it kind of works this year, winning our home games and you know, drawing our away games is probably going to be good enough to get us promoted. Now, you know, we're actually aiming a little bit higher than that. And I think that given the run of games we've got at home to Stockport, at home to Mansfield, yes, we've got Crewe away, that's a tricky one. We, you know, our away games are supposedly against some of the lesser lights in the division, albeit, you know, a thing that we've known for the last 2 years is that everywhere we go, they're going to have a record crowd. It's going to be a cup final for them. They're going to fight tooth and nail. Nobody rolls over for us. You know, you sometimes, you know, when you're watching the highlights of other teams and divisions games, you see teams give up in matches because they're like, oh, Lord, you know, we're 2-0 down or we're 3-0 down or whatever. Nobody ever gives up against us. We have to fight tooth and nail for everything. And so actually, you know, having just said like, well, we're going to lots of the teams down the bottom, they will sit in, they'll make it as difficult as they possibly can. I mean, I thought it was interesting yesterday against Gillingham. For me, it looked like they were playing for a draw, Gillingham. They were more than happy to get a draw. And, you know, they scrapped a goal. Now, obviously, results disappointing. We wanted 3 points or a point. We didn't get any. But I think it's a sign of, you go away to a playoff chasing team, you know, who were a preseason favorite, who, you know, got lots of resources, spent well. They are, you know, they celebrated like it's like they won the cup or something. And that is, I think that those kind of perspectives from the outside tell you that generally everybody else thinks we're having a very good season.
Yeah. I wear the scarf that everyone wants, right? So
yeah, I think so. I mean, like, that's something that we're always going to have to contend with until we get to a point where we are, you know, knocking or rubbing shoulders and bumping heads with, you know, big teams. And there are lots of big teams in this division, and every team in this division is deserving of respect. But there are lots for whom it's very exciting to have Wrexham to come to town. And not just like, I don't mean the players and the managers, they treat every fixture the same way they would, but for the fans and things, and they turn out in big numbers, and they, you know, we know what an effect the race course has on our form at home. And I think Notts County at home was an incredible example of that, because that's the noisiest I've heard us all season. And you could see how that roared the team on to like a very hard fought win. That's what every away team is getting every game. They're getting their biggest, noisiest crowd of the season. And, you know, it's difficult for us to combat that. We'd like to do it better, but, you know, ultimately, at the end of the day, provided we get promoted, how we do it, I'm not too worried about.
Yeah, quite. I was going to say, you know, you mentioned the WhatsApp group there. Like how are the owners following it at the moment? Are they follow? I'm guessing they're sort of feeling every kick and every late sort of winner and equaliser that goes in.
Yeah, and they always have. You know, I mean, they love the. It's funny because it. Well, I say they always have. I think as everyone knows, they both have gone on a bit of a journey with the football side of it. You know, the objective was always to do with the town and the team and the community and all those sorts of things. But I think they've both really fallen in love with the game. So, you know, the excitement when we score, the desolation when we concede, the frustration when we can't do it, all that is very real and palpable. But it's important for us to kind of make sure that we don't get too carried away with it, because I think that it's, you know, we were a bit doom and gloom yesterday, just because I think it adds to the frustration when you go somewhere and you do play the way we did, and to, you know, create a fair few chances and not take them, but equally sort of those frustrating moments where things broke down the final third, balls get played behind people, we pass when we shoot when we should pass, all those sorts of things can all be very frustrating. But for us, it's really important to kind of try and zoom out and take a more macro view of everything and live by seasons rather than by games.
I suppose as well, you know, Tuesday'd be a big example of that, because I remember thinking last week, you know, 3 away games in 7 days is never easy. It doesn't matter where they are on the table. And, you know, if we'd have got 6 points from those 3, I'd have been delighted. So we win on Tuesday and, you know, suddenly everyone's a lot perkier, aren't they, right?
Yeah, we're on Tuesday. We're back in the automatic playoff positions. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't have, you know, we've had this weekend was one of those ones where I think it was last weekend was the opposite, where we won and everybody else fumbled, you know, fluffed their lines, and suddenly everyone's like, we're gonna win the league, and then you have a week where Crewe win, Mansfield win, okay, Stockport drew, and we lose, and it's like, oh my god, it's, you know. Parkinson, not only does he need to go, he should resign himself for this, the ignominy of losing a football match, a thing that's unheard of. Yeah, you know, as you say, win on Tuesday, we're right back sort of where we want to be. We'd be within, I mean, what it works out as now, it would put us, within touching distance of the top of the league. I can't remember what the exact number is, without looking at the league now. So yeah, we just got to, you know, ultimately we've got to keep doing what we're doing, win games, you know, get promoted.
Humphrey, can I change the angle a little bit? Where are we on the COP? So I think I'm right in thinking that we've not really signed the heads of terms with the council at the moment. But is everything else in place? I know WST, I've surrendered the lease. The Transformers done, I think. Am I right in thinking there?
Yeah, we've ticked off a lot of the things that we need to do. I mean, ultimately, part of it is gearing up to find, you know, outside financing and stuff like that as well, because the council are paying for a big chunk of it. We need to find another big chunk of it. And that was something that kind of couldn't start in earnest until various hoops had been jumped through, et cetera, et cetera. So, yeah, I mean, our objective is still, you know, to get started at the end of the season, basically. So it's not, you know, we haven't quite crossed all the T's and dotted all the I's, but that remains the objective.
So, and I know we sort of said that maybe the temporary stand isn't making money. I mean, I find that quite surprising, actually, because, you know, it's full all the time. So could you sort of take me through why it isn't?
The longer it's up for, obviously, the more it pays for itself, basically. Right. So when we, you know, and obviously now you will have seen it's now being sponsored. So that's another thing that has added to that. So, you know, without the sponsorship, without this, you know, you've got operating costs. We have to staff it. We have to do this, that, and the other. You know, it had a base level of cost at the start. I think if we had just kept it open, operational through to the end of the season, that didn't quite clean its own face, or whatever the phrase is. Right? That's a phrase, isn't it? I think.
It is now, yeah.
I was going to say, yeah, I've never heard of it, but I'm happy.
Wipe its own face, I think, is...
Is it wipe its own face?
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah,
you're cleaning. So. I mean, when you're wiping, you're cleaning.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Certainly,
yeah.
I am. I'm rarely wiping without cleaning. and So the four wall sponsorship basically has meant that that's a chunk of money that has, I think, tipped it over into profitability at this stage. Obviously we don't want it open next season. We want to be getting on with building, but if, you know, God forbid it is open next season, then we'll be making money there.
Yeah. I'm sorry. I don't mean it's to great, be the guy who gives you the difficult questions, but where are you with the training ground?
Yes. The real hat trick. again, still searching for appropriate spaces. I know as it happens that, this has been a big topic conversation around the building for us and at board level of late. So I think that we've, you know, assembled the candidates for different sites, and a big conversation about that is due like this week, basically, as in starting tomorrow, Monday, whenever people listen to this.
Yeah, fair enough. Going back to sort of injuries, maybe, I want to like concentrate on the football a little bit. And so I want to talk about Paul Mullin. He's not started the last three games. Obviously, he's our talisman. He's our sort of star man. Do you think that injury that he suffered in pre-season maybe affected him a little bit more than he let on?
I think the big thing about it, and my guess would be, is that Paul missed a big chunk of pre-season off the back of that. And that is often where you are building that kind of brutal core fitness that you know you associate with professional footballers. I think, you know, weirdly, the base level that gets laid down there for your fitness is critical to the rest of the season, and that got heavily disrupted with Paul. And obviously, he's had a lot of time to recover since then. But, you know, I think there he's also been carrying some other knocks and bruises and bumps of late. So there's been a palpable effort. I mean, injuries have been so weird for us this year because they've come in kind of clusters, and they've clustered in particular positions. So we obviously had that period where we had, you know, Aaron, Tunney, Owen O'Connell, all out at the same time. Then now currently it's central midfield. That seems to be where we're really light, with George and JJ. Tommy's out as well, who you know, I should have added him. He's in both camps for that thing, for those injuries. So it's interesting. One thing I will say, because again, I sometimes look on the internet, statistically, our injury stuff is actually very good. It always seems like everybody thinks their team is really suffering from an injury crisis, but actually, you know, we've missed a lot more minutes per player in the squad than pretty much anyone else in the division, and those numbers stack up very well going up through the whole of the EFL. So, you know, Kevin and his team, I think, are doing an amazing job of getting everybody back. We often get players back faster than we were expecting. But yeah, it's definitely, I think it's disrupted us. There's no question of that in different periods. You know, there was a point at which everyone was like, you know, our attack and midfield's all working great. Defense is a bit shambolic. Defense has been really strong, I think, in the last few weeks. You know, I think Max has done brilliantly. I think Owen's done brilliantly since he's come in. I really feel for Boyle because I think he, you know, did great when he came back in and then, you know, got a red card that was, you know, I'm going to say questionable. I think that's probably as far as I can get away with, because lots of people are like, it's not questionable at all. And then, you know, two yellow cards the other day, I think was, you know, there are lots of situations in which you're not seeing a player being sent off for the offences given there. So I think he's been very unlucky. And again, yesterday, I thought that Max, Owen and Tunney did brilliantly. So defensively, I think we've been very strong at a point at which, you know, injuries further forward and up the pitch have hampered some of our attacking prowess. So, yeah, you know, I mean, I think when we've got everyone together, we've got everyone fit, when everyone's firing, then we're a different prospect. And I think Paul, you know, I know from talking to him, you know, he's disappointed with the way the season's panned out for him personally. But I think that there's, you know, a very real possibility that you'll see him come back with a full pre-season next season, you know, fully recovered, and he'll bang a load of goals in League One.
Tim, how do you want to jump on?
Can't argue with that one. Yeah, no, just touching on, Humphrey, what you said there about you mentioned Will Boyle and the sending off. When we won the league last year, I'm pretty sure we were top of the Fair Play League. That played a big, I personally think that played a big part in keeping that group together, keeping that sort of fluidity, if you like. We're not anywhere near top of the Fair Play League this year. Is that? Do you feel that that has hindered the team? As we can mention the injuries as well, but surely, whether it's because it's a more of a physical nature league too, I don't know. I'm just interested to see what your thoughts were on that.
I think first of all, the philosophy hasn't changed at all. So you know, I don't think we've suddenly become a group of dirty players overnight, or Phil saying like you've got to put a few equalizers in on them early to make them know they're in a game, or any of those sorts of things. I mean, when you look at the kind of the nature of the sendings off, I think they have been. I think the speed of the league has maybe surprised one or two, even players who are used to playing in League Two or League One or whatever it is, who've then done a season in the National League where you perhaps have a little bit more time. You know, they've just been caught out in certain situations. You know, I think of back to like George Evans's red card. You know, that was one where, you know, he just goes to play the ball and doesn't, the guy gets his ankle in front of it. Like it's, you know, I think it's sending off because I think he's out of control. But I think it's one where normally he nicks that ball away from someone who's, you know, late on him or whatever it may be. And I just think some of those situations we've been slightly unlucky. I also think, you know, there's a lot of pressure on these players. There's a lot of pressure to perform, as we talked about, as we first alluded to. You know, there's a, you know, unless we win every single game, we're losing. And I think sometimes they've let that pressure get to them, maybe, and a desire to win the ball, or a desire to do something has caused them to make a mistake. I think that, you know, I think it's, I will say, the final thing I'll say is, I do truly think, and I know I've seen Phil mention this, so I think I can get away with saying this, I do think there's an area where we suffer sometimes is there's so much speculation around Wrexham and referees, and are we given an easy ride? Are we given this? Is there Disney are paying for this, blah, 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 blah. And I do think that sometimes referees are really eager to be seen, to not be being affected by the big reputation team or by the crowd or by the whatever, because there's definitely been a few instances of stuff. I mean, funnily enough, George, I think the last game George played for us, he got absolutely smashed from behind. I mean, like an absolutely crazy challenge, like scissoring straight through him into, you know, studs up on him. And it wasn't even a free kick. And I mean, I was absolutely flabbergasted by that, because it was, you know, it doesn't have to be a red card. The idea that that wasn't a free kick to me felt like a situation where like that's someone overcompensating for something. I mean, you see that. So looking back at MK Dons, Dean Lewington, whatever their centre back.
The guy who stamped on Andy.
Yes, right. I mean, incredibly obvious, clear stamp on Andy Cannon. Nothing happens. So he then gets sent off for over remonstrating with the referee. Well, that to me smacks maybe referee thinking, oh, I should have done something about that earlier. I'm going to overcompensate here. You know, just those strange decisions, you know, yeah. Boyle getting sent off, you're like, you were quite keen to kind of to tie that one up, you know, potentially. Like you weren't sad you had an opportunity to make it 10v10. So
is it why Ollie Palmer repeatedly gets rugby tackled to the ground as well, and no one seems to ever do anything?
And I mean, Paul, I saw Mark Griffiths in commentary saying about you know, what a challenge on Paul yesterday, if that's not a foul then I'm a hat rack. And I do agree that, you know, Paul does on occasion, you know, Paul makes the most of things. That's part of the modern game. That's we see players do that against us week in, week out. But I do think there are lots of situations where we're seeing him getting absolutely tossed all over the place. And because referees have decided that, oh, he's a tricky one, or he does X, Y, and Z, he gets given a very tough time. Ollie has the challenge that I had when I played, which was that when you're as tall or big, you know, a big, or let's be honest, as beefcake hunky as we both are, you get very little off referees, because they always think if you get knocked over, they're like, well, come on, you're a big lad, like you should be able to handle that. And say, right, well, I can't. That's why why I fell over, because that man over there tripped me up, referee. and I do think that, you know, you see that. I mean, Peter Crouch is another one. Like big, tall strikers often don't get that much off referees, I think. That's my conspiracy theory.
Yeah, the bigger they are, the harder they fall, and all that sort of stuff.
That's it. That's it.
Documentary, not a million miles away from season three. Obviously, a little bit earlier than what we were perhaps, everybody was perhaps expecting. Is that just to kind of help maintain the sort of momentum of everything and to keep everybody informed of how things are going kind of, you know, as it is, as opposed to having to wait?
Yeah, I think one of the things that they, you know, the documentary gang all kind of were a bit frustrated about was that, you know, we obviously won the title in May. It was incredibly exciting. And then we couldn't share that, those moments until, you know, whenever it was, October, you know, and by that stage, we're often finding that viewers of the documentary are a bit confused as to what's going, you know, they don't, because of the, they think it's happening kind of in real time. And so, you know, there's just a desire to try and bring those two things into closer alignment. So, you know, I think the idea is that, you know, the finale would only be a few weeks after the end of the season, basically. So you're, what you're going to be watching is in pretty real time.
Wow. Okay. And I know when I spoke to you at the Gwersel Reds thing, I think you'd seen some of the earlier episodes, and you said that. I mean, you've obviously seen a lot of it. How's it stacking up for you? Is it as good as the others? There's going to be different character arcs and so on.
Yeah. Well, of the episodes that I've seen, so I've seen the first three so far, and I think one of the things that I'm liking a lot about these ones is how much kind of inside the dressing room stuff there is, which I know is something that you know, collectively, the four of us like that kind of stuff. We're football fans. We like seeing, you know, what's going on. And for me, you know, I very rarely go in the dressing room. If I do, it's sort of, there's something that I have to get off one of the players right before the game, or like sometimes I might, I don't think I've ever been in after a game, because I always feel like that's quite a sacrosanct space, really. I don't think, you know, any Tom, Dick and Harry should go wandering in there. So I love seeing all the kind of like, oh, it's half time at you know, I think there's a bit of, do we get a bit of half time at MK Dons? I can't remember. But it's kind of, you know, you're seeing some of the, you know, the real coal face of what it means to play for this football club, what it means to manage this football club. And I think that, you know, I'm very confident that most of the people that make the time to listen to this podcast will really enjoy those bits.
Very good. I think before I sort of have my sort of final question, before I chuck it back to the other guys, with that as well, I think obviously you see the documentary crew knocking around and asking questions and certain things. And I think one of the ones that in recent weeks, especially during this kind of leaner spell of results, I think that some of the questions that were being asked of fans was around Phil Parkinson. It's like, you know, what do you think of this? What do you think of that? And it's a slightly different angle, which is right, you know, because it can be all sweetness and light and flowery and this, that and the other. And so there is going to be something, whether it makes the cut or not, I don't know. But it's quite interesting to have that different approach to things, really, especially when, you know, there's people aren't used to seeing Wrexham losing. So the question is being asked by the documentary crew to some of the fans. I mean, has that surprised you that that's been put out there, or is it just a case of
you've got
to allow all opinions, I suppose?
Well, it's got to be reflective of what's going on. I mean, you know, the reality is that, I mean, again, I think it's as important for the documentary and documentary makers and documentary viewers as it is for any of us to put it into perspective, right? This is, you know, since we took over, we have not had a bad season. You know, the first season, you know, we finished second. That's disappointing. That wasn't the objective, but it's not a bad season. You know, last season, obviously great. We love that. This season is shaping up to be a very good season. But I think even if we were, God forbid, to miss out on automatic promotion and go into the playoffs, that has to be a good season. At some point, probably, we're going to have a bad season. We are going to have a thing where we've whether that's in League One or the Championship or wherever, where it's not going well, where we are, you know, we're losing most weeks, where things are a challenge. And I think it's incredibly important that we all collectively are mentally prepared for that. You know, I often talk about when I first went to watch Liverpool, which was prior to my time with Wrexham, was the team that I took an interest in. shall we say. I started going there in about, I think 2001 was the first game I went to see there. And it was a strange old place because it was a place of a massive hangover of, you know, 25, 30 years of dominating English and European football. And everybody really struggled with the fact that Liverpool weren't that great anymore. And, you know, they weathered that storm, in which they, you know, won a European Cup and won FA Cups and did all sorts of things. But that period in which, you know, Liverpool fans were like, oh, these are the doldrums. We've got, you know, what's his name? Paul Konchesky playing at left back and Roy Hodgson's the manager. And oh my God, it's all terrible. But it's obviously come back around to a period of, like, you know, the last 10 years since Klopp got in there of, you know, some of the best times that club's ever enjoyed. So there will be ebbs, there will be troughs. You know, I was thinking about this watching the Carabao Cup today. You know, Chelsea obviously had that, you know, insane period where they were so good. Right now they've got their richest Croesus, but they can't seem to work out what they're doing. They're signing all these players for hundreds of millions. You know, it just seems like a little bit of a shambles in some respects. And, you know, ultimately, I think the documentary has got to reflect what's happening right now. You can't just constantly be rose-tinted goggles, because that bump back down to earth will be even more brutal if it's like, everything's great, everyone's having a brilliant time, we're the best team in the whole universe. You know, you see some of the reactions right now to us not being 20 points ahead in League Two in our first season back in the league.
Before I asked you about a US tour, Humphrey, what is that tattoo you've got on your upper right arm that you've just glimpsed through? I didn't know you.
Oh, this one.
Look at that.
Yeah, it's like a woodcut of some beans. That's my nickname for my wife. So I got beans tattooed on my arm.
Is that you?
No, this is very old. I've had this, I don't know, what is this, 10 years old or something now? Maybe.
Okay.
I've got this one as well, which looks like sort of, it looks a bit white power. It's not.
I was about to say.
Yeah, unfortunately, it's a Viking symbol of a raven, and there's a long and boring story behind it. But I,
it's a good job your hand was at that angle.
Yes, you got the right angle to do. Yes, yeah, yeah. I got it 10 years ago or something like that, and I was very, very proud of it, and then showed a friend of mine who was like, is that not? It looks like a sort of SS Panzer Division symbol they paint on the side of their tanks. I was like, well, it's not, and it's not supposed to be.
Humphrey, I'm going to jump in on the US because I've got a vested interest in it. So I want to know, right? I'm definitely going to go, right? I want to know, where am I going? Come on, plan my route so I can get
top,
a cheap
top red
now.
Andy.
Okay, what can I tell you? Let's see. So your route, you live in London, don't you, Andy?
Yeah, I do. Yeah.
Yeah, so you want to get on the Elizabeth line to Heathrow, okay, probably, or maybe the Piccadilly line, depending on, I don't know exactly where you live.
Well, I'm pretty cheap, so I think the Piccadilly line is going to be better for me.
This is the 150th more... Oh, by the way, so a bit of okay. Juicy exclusive gossip will not go amiss.
Oh,
thank
blimey.
You.
No, well, you know, you're... you may go... Oh, what am I allowed to say? Not a lot, unfortunately.
Which
so
terminal?
I'm trying to think of...
What?
Terminal, well, depending on which airline you're on, I've three or
it
five.
It won't be BA, mate. It won't be BA. Don't worry about that.
Okay, so probably three. Yeah, you should book a flight to America.
There you go. Just go Kansas. Go for the middle.
Humphrey.
Oh, yes, that's a good idea.
Are we going to be crisscrossing sort of like, you know, the whole of North America, or are we going to be
one of the objectives? One of the objectives we've had is to increase the amount of time we'll be able to spend training. And the amount of time we'll be able to spend, you know, concentrating on matches rather than travel, if that makes sense. So there will still be an element of travel, certainly. But we realize that actually, probably with the resources we have, where we don't have a giant branded, you know, private jet like Chelsea or Arsenal or someone, it's probably best for us that we minimize the amount of time we have to spend on sort of, you know, cross-country flights and this, that, and the other.
Will we be seeing that in clear work? I want to know if we're going to see Max Kluwerth marking Lionel Messi. Is that going to happen? That's what we want to see.
I don't think so. I don't think so, but I would, you know, I think Max would take that in his stride.
Yeah. Right. Let's
Andy, you can strike Miami off your list.
Let's stop putting poor Humphrey in uncomfortable positions where he's forced to think of something to say. Let's move on. Thank you for your time, Humphrey. Quickly, if you're willing to stay with us for an extra 5 minutes, we'd be grateful. Say you listen occasionally to the podcast. Are you familiar with something that has inexplicably become a regular feature, which is the Book of Okonkwo?
I regret to inform you that I am very aware of it.
Okay. I think it's time that we come on to that now, Tim. Get it over with. As we've got an honoured guest here. Can you?
What one, Tim?
I mean, I'll be honest. I'm not going to do what was voted for this week because I've had man flu. I haven't got the pipes for it because Ness and Dormer was voted in by some sick elements of our fan base. So they voted for Andy's effort, which, as I said, I'm not going to do this week, but I will do next week. I'm going to prep for it. I'm going to try and get my best Pavarotti chops on. However, I'll do my level best. And seeing as Humphrey's now brought the dog in, I've got to make sure that the dog doesn't get scared by this.
A bit of a treat for everyone. Well, I've got headphones in, so he can't hear anything.
Classic case, right, is if you can't beat them, join them. So we all know at the moment the whole Okonkwo thing has gone down to the tequila tune, blah de blah blah. So I've come up with the lyrics to the actual tune, which, you know, the lyrics that nobody's going to use, the lyrics that nobody's going to need, the lyrics that nobody really needs to hear. But I came up with this about an hour ago, there, give or take. So bear with me on this one, okay? Bear with me, because this is the first time I'm just going to blast it out. So first lot, I'll just let it run, and then the second lot I'll pipe in with. By the Champs, by the way, if you don't know. Here comes the first lot. Beautiful. Not yet. We know that bit. Just building up to it nicely. I missed my cue.
Right. Oh my God.
I'm going to try it again.
Let's we're really going to make right, 7 minutes of quality right. Here of audio.
Go. I've got it now. Go on now.
Hold it up to the mic, mate.
He came to the town from Arsenal. He came to the town on loan. He came to replace Ben Foster. Don't ever want to let him go. Don't let him go. Don't let him go. He plays in goal. Sign him on a 10-year deal. Okonkwo, come on. That's not bad. Not bad.
That was worthy of the 150th episode of this August podcast.
Put it in the awards folder. Put it in the awards folder.
Yeah, it is. It's 150th.
He came to the town from Arsenal. Wow. He came to the town alone. He came to replace Ben Foster. Don't ever want to let him go. Don't let him go. Don't let him go. He plays in goal. Sign him on a 10-year deal. Okonkwo.
He plays in goal. Save that. Because I was worried about it, and then that made me laugh a bit.
Okay. Well, as long as it gets a few belly laughs or minor titters, then that's fine.
Mm. Not Tim, if I could give you some advice as a performer of your
treader of the boards. Yes.
Don't do yourself down. Don't let these snakes, cover up your shine or whatever the phrase is. Don't let them rain on your parades.
Dull your sparkle.
You know, we the audience want to know. Oh look, there it's me and Sean Locke.
I mean, I'm just pointing this up because Andy, a person who looks so different in every single shot I see him in.
See, Andy's just gone and dulled my sparkle. You were in the middle of a
Humphrey was in the middle of a monologue. Yeah.
Yes, rude man. Go on, go back.
I'm just saying, you know, I mean, we the audience, you know, we want to know we're in for a treat, right? So you also shouldn't tell us that what you're about to do is terrible. You should be bigging it up. Sell it. Look at Donald Trump. That's his master power, right? Is that he just tells everyone everything he does is brilliant and loads of people believe him.
Okay, wow. Look.
Even when it's not.
This podcast, if you're hashtagging, we'll have the words white power in Donald Trump. And it's all a bit
the word cloud is
Yeah, look,
the word tired is a bit disappointing.
That's good advice. I'll take it on board for next week. We'll try and deliver some hype.
Reese, before we do predictions, yeah. Can I just sort of say, if you want a free copy of the Fearless and Devotion fanzine, just email me, Andrew Gilpin.
Has it got to the point where you're begging for free ones now to get them away?
No, I'm giving them for free, Reese. I'm not making any money out of this.
Oh yeah, fair enough. Yeah,
I've got two boxes in my shed. I'm just going to give them out.
I've got a copy already, Andy. Thank you. It's really sweet of you, but
that's fine.
Andy just wants to talk to people. He just wants to email people. So please email
just
him.
Want some pen pals?
Yeah. But no. Good. Well mentioned, Andy. Let's go on to predictions. Quickly, Tim. Do we have a message from Neil to play out, or should we play it next week?
No, we've got it. We do have it. It's a quick one. So yeah, Neil, our friend Neil Smith, did a walk from Denby to Old Trafford in memory of his late brother. Raised over $5,000 for the Mind charity. Here's his message of thanks.
Hello to the Fearless and Devotion lads. Thank you again for letting me on here to talk about my brother and our adventure. As everyone probably know, mine and Adam's brother passed away early December, and we after the funeral, we decided to raise money for something, and obviously it was going to be Mind, which do fantastic work for mental health. And as people that knew Chris knew his conditions, and he suffered from mental health. So what we did was we took Chris's ashes and we walked from Denby, where he lived, to Old Trafford, and it was 60 miles over 3 days. And when we got there, Man United couldn't have been nicer to us. They showed us everywhere. They walked through the tunnel. It was fantastic. I just want to say thank you to everyone, to the Fearless listeners, the people I know around Wrexham and the world, it seems, that have donated towards our Mind charity. Altogether, we've raised over $7,000. So as you can think, my family and me, just want to say thank you so much, and just very proud to know every single one of you. And I'm sure Chris will be proud as well. So, diolch yn fawr all. Carry on the cracking work, boys, up the town. And again, thank you, everyone, really.
So, yeah, there's Neil. I'm very proud of him.
Oh, man.
That's great.
Yeah, so you can still go on his Just Giving page, if I can find it. If you go, there's a Just Giving thing. If you go on his Twitter, you can find him at WXM Smith. You can find all of his details there for the Just Giving site. So, yeah, a proper stellar effort, and managed to get the message on. Thanks to Neil for that.
Oh, man. Well done, Neil. Really good effort. Let's close this up now by doing predictions. So we've got Forest Green on Tuesday, and then on Saturday, we've got Accrington Stanley at home. Andy, why don't you go first?
Right. He's not started for the last three games. Unleash the Mullin. Unleash him against Forest Green. I think even if he's not... Yeah, well, obviously, he's a bit out of form. Yeah, we know that. But, you know, the threat of him is worth more than anything, and I think we're going to win. I think it's going to be tight. I think it's going to be 2-1. And then on Saturday, I think with that confidence throwing through us, I think it's going to be a little bit easier. You just got that whole sort of home team sort of stance there. Four sides again, the four walls stand, which we know it now. I reckon that's going to be 2-0.
Nice. Tim?
I think we'll see more changes again, and you know, a lot of people saying, oh well, you know, chopping and changing, disrupting the team, but that's what you're going to get with squad depth. That's what you're going to get. That's what happens. So you know, we're no different to any other team, and you can't keep playing the same 11 over and over and over, because they'll just get burnt out. So I think we will edge it at Forest Green. They will give it all. They've coming off on a very good win, but I think we'll nick it. Just going off our other away wins tend to be by 1-0. So I'm going to follow that suit with that and go for a 1-0 win at Forest Green. Accrington, with their fans coming down with their nice discounted tickets by Fiverr, I think it was. I think Home advantage again. Obviously, we'll be fine. We'll be fine. The fourth wall, as Andy said, I think that'll be 2-0, and we'll have back-to-back clean sheets, which will be nice. Which will be nice. So you'll go with that one.
That would be lovely. I'll go next. I think Dale Vince's Eco Warriors are going to hold us to a draw on Tuesday night. I'll be there, and I've got a terrible record this year, which is why I'm not very confident of a win. But I think it'll be a solid performance, say 1-1, and then I'm going to join everyone in their confidence and say we'll do Akron and Stanley 3-1. I've never heard of them anyway. So, Humphrey, what about you?
I mean, I'm very nervous about making score predictions, but I will say that I think that we will. I'm confident that we'll win both games. I think the most recent away performances have pointed towards much more control of games, much more understanding. You know, we're struggling with injuries. We're very light. I mean, that's I think the reason why Paul is not starting is not form. It's more to do with managing his minutes. As we are across the board. So, you know, my big prediction is that Sean Harvey and Andy Holt from Accrington Stanley will shoot daggers at each other across the boardroom. That's the one thing I know will definitely happen. Wanted to be correct in my predictions. So yeah, I think we'll win both games. I think we will everyone will be back on a high on Saturday thinking we're the best team in the universe. And that's what I'm pushing.
I think they should settle it in a good old fashioned arm wrestle. That'd be good.
I suggested they should just get the William Aston Hall and get a ring in there and then just go at each other in front of a paying audience.
I was going to say, failing that, could you ask him if he'll come on the podcast for us? We'll get Andy Holt and we'll do a episode 151. You know, you get just have it out and we'll just watch.
I'm back for Accrington, so I'm looking forward to that. I'm going to be very, very jet lagged, but I'm going to be there.
Good man. We'll look forward to seeing you there. Thanks to anyone for listening. As regular listeners will know, we no longer have an email address, so please don't email us.
We do.
Do we?
Yeah, he does like forward. The guy who owns our email address does actually forward stuff onto us.
He doesn't own it. Well, yeah, that's just to give anybody else access to it. That's the difference. Yeah,
the least prepared sort of podcast.
So, okay, channel, sorry, the email address that might get through to us via a third party is fidzine@gmail.com. Or you can just
fanzine. If you want a fanzine, andrewgilpin@hotmail.com. I will send you anywhere in the world. Doesn't matter. Just cover your postage.
And it sounds so terrible. That's great. Thank you, Andy. It's very generous of you. Lastly, yeah, if you want to get in contact, it's probably best to DM Phyllis and Devotion on X, previously Twitter. Thanks, everyone, for listening, and goodbye.
Cheers.
Bye.